Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 75 for the 26th of March, 2023. Back in October, Liz and I were making a delivery. I had done an overhaul on a really, really nice Singer vibrating shuttle machine for viewer Maria, who lives up in Westchester County, New York, up in the New Rochelle-ish area. And when we had originally got the machine from Maria, we met halfway, like at a rest area on the Garden State Parkway. We picked up the machine. We went and did things we had to do. Maria went back home, yada, yada, yada. Anyway, machine's done. We go to take it up to Maria. But in the interim of all this, viewer Tony, who lives up in southwestern Connecticut, not far from where Maria lives, had contacted me. And she said that she had a couple sewing machines that she thought I might be interested in. And if I wanted them, I could have them. So conversation went back and forth. I'm like, sure, we'll stop in. We're going to be up in your neck of the woods the next couple of days, blah, blah, blah. So we go up to deliver the machine to Maria, the vibrating shuttle machine. We spend some time with her. Then we head on over to Tony's place. And we met with Tony and her husband. And what Tony had for us was this 201-2, a 99, and I think the other thing is a white of some variety. I'd have to look at it. I honestly do not remember. It is actually sitting in a place because it's going to another home. It's actually going to our friend Joe down in Crofton, Maryland. Hi, Joe. Anyway, moving right along. I had mentioned this 201 and the 99 in a video months ago, saying that I had gotten these from Tony, and what I was going to be doing was, because these are excess to my needs, I was just going to renovate them, offer them up for sale, and the proceeds of those machines were going to go to benefit the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association, which is our favorite charity, which is up the road in Leonardo, New Jersey. Anywho, I was contacted by viewer Kathy out in Montana, of all places, and she was very interested in the 201, so I'm like, sure. So we talked about it. We negotiated a price for it and a couple of other things that she specifically needed, like she wants an electronic foot controller for it. Not a problem. Got one on order. It'll be here tomorrow. But then issues, the family issues, you know, with my mom and everything, kind of cropped and got in the way. Kathy was very understanding, like, take care of biz, no big deal. Well, I finally got this machine finished. And I want to talk about this machine, specifically some of the things that I went through with it. Some things that if you're going to tackle a major overhaul, and this, ladies and gents, was a major overhaul. This machine was absolutely filthy. And that's not Tony's fault. I got it from Tony in as found condition. Let me qualify that completely right now. I had a thought process behind what I was doing with this machine. I want to share that with you. There was a couple of parts that were missing on this. I want to discuss the importance of keeping a parts inventory, but more important, having a parts supply chain. And a couple of other things that are really important in doing this kind of a project. So grab yourself a cup of coffee and we'll get into it. This 201-2, her serial number was allocated September 22nd of 1937, which makes her over 85 years young. You can tell by looking at her that she is pretty well preserved, although had I taken before pictures, you would have been appalled. She was absolutely filthy. And that, by the way, is no reflection on the woman who gave me the machine. When Tony gave it to me, it was in as found condition. So, yeah, that's not on her. That's just on age and where it had been stored previous to her acquiring it. She does have a couple of little paint chips missing, some scratches that I couldn't quite get out. But all in all, she came up pretty nice. Mechanically, she is now flawless. The underside, as you see, it was completely apart and was cleaned. Everything in the business end here, let me just pull this off real fast. As you can see, that cleaned up in my typical style. That came up absolutely beautifully. So I'm quite happy with this one. I am very content that she came out as nicely as she did. Of course, she got a complete rewire, both light, motor, power switch, everything is done. I did go digging through. I've got a complete selection of original accessories for it. I don't have an original accessories cardboard box, but these things, actually Liz and I went up to Hobby Lobby. They sell these. They call it a 10-pack, but it's actually 5 boxes, 5 lids for $3.50. So yeah, these are an economical way of storing accessories for these machines. Now, Kathy wants an electronic foot controller for this, so I've got that on order. That should be here tomorrow, so I can ship this machine out. But let's talk a little bit about the process of doing one of these. I'm becoming more and more an advocate of checklists, either written or a mental checklist, but written checklists are far more reliable. So the first thing I always do, any one of these machines, 201, a 66, a featherweight, whatever, the very first thing I do, I don't care whether the machine sews or not, I don't care if the motor runs, I don't care if the light works, none of that is important. First thing I do is I inspect the wiring. Now, I've got a little piece of video here, which you can see. I'll put it up in the corner. You can see what this motor looked like when I started taking it apart. Or when I should say, while I was working on the wiring, it was in pretty sad shape. I have here another motor, which is very similar condition-wise. This came off of a parts donor machine. This is as found. You can see, yeah, this is why you look at the wiring first. The black chunks are what's left of the insulation, plus there's some electrical tape on it. But yeah, you want to make sure that you look at the motor, look at the wiring, before you even ever think of plugging one of these in. This would just send sparks flying. And if you were touching the machine, you'd probably get a good zap as well. So yeah, make sure you look at the wiring. And speaking of wiring, from the same parts machine, this light assembly came out. And no joke, I don't know where they got this socket that they put into this. This is definitely not Singer original. The housing is obviously Singer original, but the light socket is not. The shroud is partially Singer original, but the wiring is not. But look what they did here. I mean, come on, guys. Yeah, this is why you look at everything. You see that? Somebody wrapped tape on it. They didn't even wrap the tape over exposed conductor here. You see that? So yeah, always inspect your wiring before you do anything else. Always. All right, now this particular machine, her upper thread tension unit that was on it when I got it from Tony was not the normal black Singer upper thread tension unit. I don't think it was actually a Singer upper thread tension. I think it was somebody had somewhere along the line put a replacement one on, and they stole parts from like one of the Japanese machines from the 1950s. It didn't look right. and it definitely was not period correct for this machine. It was also missing the power switch for the light. The wiring on this was a complete disaster, and it was also missing the bobbin winder on the motor. Fortuitously, I happened to have the bobbin winder pieces in my pile of stuff in the parts cabinets, as well as having an upper thread tension unit, and I had a couple of extra switches, so I had all these parts on hand. But what I did was, after I identified the parts I needed, pulled them out of stock and set them in the tray with all the other parts, as I put all the parts into a tray. Once I put them in with all the other parts for this machine, and then I went and I sourced replacement parts that I could replenish my stocks with. Do you need to do that? Absolutely not. In my circumstance, because I do so many of these, I absolutely had to, because I see machines on a daily basis, new machines. You know, I might get one of these every 2 weeks or something like that. And if I start just using all of my stocks on hand, I might find myself up a creek without a paddle when I have to turn around and do one of these again. So, yeah, I tend to immediately try to source new parts as I need them. Of course, you know, the only other stuff this got was, it got new spool pins, felts, and a bobbin winder tire. But what I did with the spool pins, once again, these were the drive-in styles, and I took them out. I drove the originals out. They were very rusty and nasty. And from Central Michigan, I buy, there's a part number on these. I'll look it up and put it in the doobly-doo down below. But there's one particular part number where they have these that are threaded. And let me see if I can grab one here out of my pile of stuff. You'll see it has a screwdriver slot on the top. Let's see if you can see that. And it is threaded down on the base. This is threaded for 10, is it 1040, 1028? Let me look real quick. I've got the tap right here. 1028 is the thread size on that. So while I had the machine apart, I threaded those holes, test fitted the pins in. So when this machine ships across country, these pins are going to come out. They're going to go into the accessories box in a little plastic bag, along with the felts and some bobbins, so that all they're going to have to do when this machine is received is screw those back in, and they won't get snapped off in transit. So if you're going to be shipping a machine, you might want to consider that as an option. If you don't want to tap and thread something in, what I would suggest, if you're shipping the machine, ship it with at least the top pin out. Put that in a little baggie and explain to the person who you're shipping it to how to put it back in. I'm taking both of these out because, number one, they're both threaded and I can. And number two is, I don't want to take any chances. So, yeah, that's basically what this needed parts-wise. So, yeah, I made my evaluation as my first step. The very first thing I did, I looked at the electrical. And then I started looking at other places on the machine. And I looked for other missing parts. Obviously, I knew I was going to want to change out the upper thread tension. And it was obvious that the bobbin winder was missing. So, what next? Well, I start with my disassembly. And on this particular model, I actually started my disassembly on the bottom of the machine. Now, let me turn her over and prop her up just a little bit here. Actually, I'm going to leave her at that angle. What came out and what didn't come out? Well, first things that came off were the covers over the gears. Then I pulled out the pivots on the motor side, the balance wheel side. I loosened the lock nuts and pulled out the pivot bolts, or loosened the pivot bolts. But I also had to, once this cover was off, I disconnected the lifting rock shaft and its connecting rod, and I disconnected the feed dog rock shaft. This is the one that's with the eccentric bolt. I disconnected those. I pulled out the pivot screws and removed these rock shafts for cleaning. What did those look like, you might wonder? Well, I have a parts machine here, which I did not clean these. I left these parts, because these parts look pretty much identical to what those did, and I can give you some examples. The connecting rod looked kind of like this. And this one is actually a little cleaner than the one that came out of that machine. The lifting rod was kind of like this. And you can see how disgusting that is. Versus now, it is nice and clean. The feed dog rock shaft pretty much, well, it didn't have as much lint on it as it, but it was definitely as grimy and grungy as this one was. And the fork for the stitch length regulator, pretty much it was identical to that in disgustingness. So yeah, I got everything out of the bottom, and I did not remove the center shaft that drives the rotating hook. I cleaned this in place. And the reason I do that, these gears have been meshed together for 85 years. I was not about to change anything with that. I was leaving that alone. What I used some green Scotch-Brite and sewing machine oil. And, well, actually, I used a lot of green Scotch-Brite. I cut it into, like, inch-wide strips. I cleaned all this up, got in here, cleaned a lot of that crap off, turned it around, got it nice and clean. Everything's working fine. Got the crud off of the gears. I actually kind of power washed that off, I guess you could say. I didn't, well, power washing might be a difficult way of putting it. Let me show you what I used. I actually flushed it, and my initial flushing was with CRC Electromotive Electric Parts Cleaner. This didn't hurt the paint, but I would not use this up above on painted surfaces. What I did was I put a couple of my old nasty terry cloth towels down, and I flushed and I sprayed the gears. And up here, I had packed in here with stuff to catch the runoff. And I flushed and I sprayed the gears to get the grease and the crud off. Then went through with an old toothbrush, turning the hand wheel, moving things around. Cleaned the crud off, flushed it some more, cleaned it, flushed it. Followed by a light oiling. After I got it dry, lightly oiled the gears with sewing machine oil. Cleaned the covers, put the covers back on, and that was enough for that portion. I would be remiss if I didn't say that if you're going to use this stuff, use it in a very well ventilated area. It's kind of potent. It's really not good to breathe in, and it does stink. For once this cover here was off and I had pulled out the rest of the stitch length regulator mechanism, the interior gears up here towards the main shaft got pretty much the same kind of a cleaning. I stuffed paper towels. Well, this was actually horizontal. This cover was off. Back cover was off. I stuffed paper towels inside the machine. Did my flushing so that the paper towels would catch it. I had to change the paper towels several times in the process, and I didn't use my expensive paper towels. I used the regular kitchen-type paper towels for that. But I got a lot of the goo off. Once again, turned the main shaft, got in there with a toothbrush, scrubba. Actually, access is best from the back for that. Once again, gave it another blast to flush it through, got it cleaned, kind of dried off, lightly oiled sewing machine oil, and it's fine. So then next step obviously was to take out everything from the needle bar box. You guys have seen me do that several times on 201s. Everything came out, got appropriately cleaned, polished, and reassembled. Now, when I had taken the the needle bar box area apart. I also removed the needle bar bushing. And when I cleaned the bushing, I then cleaned the needle bar outside of the machine, went to put, you know, test the fit of the needle bar and the bushing, and I discovered a problem. The needle bar, which moved nicely up and down in the machine while the machine was together, would not penetrate back through the top. The very end of the needle bar was slightly deformed. And I rolled it on the surface of the machine. I could see it was just a little wobbly at the end, so it was just ever so slightly damaged, ever slightly bent. So I extracted the needle bar from my 201 parts machine, and before you start thinking, wow, he just took a machine apart just for a needle bar, no, this other machine, which I'll show you the carcass in a moment, it's picked clean like a Christmas turkey right now. Actually, more like Christmas goose, I should say, or a Thanksgiving turkey. There's a little bit of cartilage on there, but not much in the way of muscle tissue. Anyway, the needle bar out of the other machine, once it was clean, worked absolutely fine in this machine's bushing. But that other, that parts machine has actually kept at least two other 201s alive. For example, I pulled the balance wheel bushing, which I guess technically is the stop motion bushings, the bushing that the balance wheel rides on the main shaft. I have a friend had a 201 that she was doing for a charity group to go to their thrift shop, where the end of the bushing was actually broken. So I extracted the bushing from my parts machine. I also, she had a broken hand wheel as well, which obviously meant that that machine had been dropped. So I extracted both the bushing and the hand wheel, serviced the hand wheel, cleaned up the bushing a bit, sent all that to her. And that helped raise some money for the organization. I believe it was Children's Hospital out in the either Redmond or Seattle area, something like that, out in the state of Washington. Anyway, so yeah, I keep parts machines around. Now, I was able to, like I said, replenish a lot of the parts that I had used out of my stock from the parts, my other parts machine, but I had also bought some other parts from my usual sources on eBay and other online sellers. Anyway, so she got a new needle bar, and I put her together. Because I had never disturbed the gears, I knew the timing should still be, if the timing was good prior, it should still be good. And once I got her back together again, I stuck a needle in her, checked the timing. Sure enough, the timing was perfect. But, and here's, once again, the importance of having a checklist. Preferably a written checklist, because I got distracted and when I put all this together, and I got it together and I got it buttoned up, but once again, I got distracted. I wasn't working from a written checklist, which now I have written checklists for just about everything, and I failed to make an important adjustment. And anyway, I get the machine together, and then the other night I start test sewing with her. The stitches looked great, and then after a few inches, boom, it was breaking the upper thread. I'm like, what the heck? Now, usually, upper threads breaking is 99% of the time it's either a bad needle inserted incorrectly, or upper thread tension mechanism out of adjustment or not put together correctly. Well, brand new needle, right out of the package. I knew that wasn't going to be the issue. I double-checked. I had put it in correctly. The upper thread tension mechanism, I took it apart, put it back together. Everything was fine. Got it reinstalled. I'm like, maybe it was a fluke. Started sewing again. It sewed a little bit. Poof, breaks the upper thread. And I'm like, what in the name of all that's gooey is going on with this thing? And then finally, after much soul searching, I'm starting to take the thing apart. I took the needle plate off. I took the presser foot off, and I'm running it, and I'm hearing a tiny click. I'm like, what? Just a very, very tiny, like a bing type sound. I'm like, well, so I get the needle plate off, I got the presser foot off, and I turn it a little bit by hand. I've got my head right down next to the throat of the machine, and I just turning it, and I hear bing, and it's driving me nuts. I'm like, what the heck is that? So I take the feed dog off, and I'm still getting that little bing sound. Well, kids, I'll be the first to admit, I don't know everything, and I am far from being perfect. But I made the rookiest of rookie mistakes, and I'll sit here and I'll confess it to you. When I put the needle bar area back together again, I did check the timing. I never checked the needle bar height. I got distracted. Something came up, phone call, dinner, I don't know what it was. I was not working from a checklist of, yeah, test this, test this, test this. I got distracted, and I completely forgot about checking the needle bar height on this machine. Going through the motions last night, trying to find the problem, yes, I heard it, and I was able to identify it eventually when I got everything torn down, and I'm looking and I'm watching, and I'm like, oh my God, that needle is going so far down. I took the end cover off, and I looked at the position of the needle bar and the needle bar clamp, and it was all the way down. This thing, you know, we're supposed to get approximately a 16th of an inch from the point of the hook to the top of the hole in the needle. We had 3/16, almost a quarter of an inch. That needle bar was so far down. And I wouldn't have felt so bad about it if I was alone at the time. But of course, Liz was in the room. Our friend Brandy was in the room. And I'm like, oh my God. Well, at least I discovered it and they didn't get a chance to say, hey, Bob, you idiot, did you look at this? But yeah, so my point being, checklists. Put your adjustments on the list. So, like, you'll know if you've checked timing, if you've checked the lateral position, the fore and aft position of the feed dogs in the needle plate. You check the needle bar height. Just even if it's a short checklist like that, make sure you got a checklist of adjustments that you need to make sure the machine is perfect. You know, get in there, you know, adjusting the position of the tensioner for the bobbin winder, adjusting the bobbin winder mechanism. All of these things you should have on a little list. And even if you do it on like an index card, you can check it off, check it off, check it off as you do it. It can stay with the machine. If the machine's going to a customer, you know, you get your little quality control thing. And it's like, yeah, these quality control checks were made. But by all means, you work with some form of a checklist so that you can tell what you've done and what you need to do. This lovely, and I'm using that sarcastically, 201 carcass. This was a part of a machine whose serial number was allocated on July 12th, 1939. This is the donor machine that gave up her needle bar for the nice clean machine you just saw. Anyway, you see how grimy and ugly this one is. This is in as found condition. You see how nasty this was. I want to show you how I got it looking nice. I'm going to give you a little demo here. I'm not going to do the whole machine. I'm only going to give you a little demonstration. I'm saying if you decide you're going to do this, you do this at your own risk, at your own peril. This is not for the faint at heart. At Harbor Freight, they have these little 12-volt Hercules polishers. They're sold as a bare tool for around $79, I think. It comes with some of the cleaning accessories, although there's other ones. Does not come with a battery nor a charger. So if you're not already invested in the 12-volt Hercules line, you're going to be looking at probably about $150 to get one of these complete. It is two-speed. Well, it's variable speed, but it is two-speed ranges. 0 to 2800 for polishing. 0 to 8300 RPMs for sanding. And this can use... it's got the bayonet on sanding discs, and you can also use WYSI wheels and stuff like that on it. But I just want to do a little bit of the deck here on this machine. I'm going to change my camera angle. I'm going to show you how nicely this cleans up. Now, what I'm going to be using with this is Meguiar's Mirror Glaze 9. This is a swirl remover compound. It's a pint. It goes for about $20. I'm going to use the foam pad. I'm just going to put a little bit on the foam pad. Not much at all. And we're going to hit... Now, this tool, by the way, also comes with a... it can go... A handle that can go into either side. I'm not going to use it here. So I'm going to smear a little bit on here. Going to go over this area here. Now you saw I did not clean this with anything else. Okay. Now, I'll take a piece of blue paper towel here and wipe that down. And you can see how that is cleaning up so far. So let me go a little bit more on there. Does not have a locking trigger. It has a lock-out trigger. The button here locks it out, does not lock it on. So, and I'm not using, like I said, I'm not using the side handle, but I am using two hands to go over that. This is cutting the crud. We'll just wipe this down. Buff that off a little bit and take a quick peek. Now you can see, now let me see if I can stand her up a little bit. Maybe that'll help you see it a little better. Side to side difference. Go a little wider on the camera shot. We're not getting reflection off of that. There we go. Starting to reflect now. You can see how clean that is versus how cruddy that is. Let me do a little bit on the other side. Now, as with any other kind of polishing operation, you got to be cognizant of what the condition of your clear coat is. Here, I'm just taking crud off. Notice I can't get underneath this arm completely. Hoping that this gives you an indication of how nice and clean that worked. Now, I had been polishing on that other machine literally for a couple of days by hand, and I did no more than what I just demonstrated here to get the worst of the crud off. So yeah, this thing is awesome. But I must warn you, these hold on with Velcro. This is this yellow thing is a rubber backing pad. You want to make sure, if when you're getting in close to something, into a vertical surface, get compound on the sides of this, but you're not going to be able to get all the way in. If this yellow backing pad makes contact, it is going to make a burn mark, and it's going to screw up the paint on the machine, and there's not going to be any repairing that. So you have to be cognizant at all times what those corners are doing. Do not jam this down into corners, because this yellow backing pad will get through and it will screw your paint up. I experimented with this on a couple of machines before I took it to the nice 201. And all I can say is if you do this, you do it at your own risk, at your own peril, but definitely find a machine you can practice on before you commit to using it on either somebody else's machine or one of your good machines or whatever. Now, this also comes with a bunch of other backing pads. There's even a wool bonnet and stuff. So there's plenty of different options for polishing that this comes with. And worst case scenario, if your headlights in your car ever get really cloudy, you can use this thing to decloud and polish your headlights back up really, really quickly. So, yeah, that's my review on the Hercules 12-volt variable speed polisher sander from Harbor Freight. I bought it with a 4-amp-hour battery, and I also bought a 2-amp-hour battery because they only had 1.4 in the store when I was there. The 2-amp-hour is a little bit smaller. Let me pull it out. You can see it. A little smaller in height here. I'll pull this one off of the tool. You can see the size difference. This is the 4. This is the 2. So, yeah, it's considerably shorter. That shouldn't make a difference in accessing parts on the sewing machine, because once again you're going to be working for the most part to the side. You're vertically challenged and limited by the length of the pad. So yeah, you're not going to get straight in underneath, but you can be kind of creative and get both sides. So anyway, like I said, if you decide you're going to do it, practice on something you don't really care about first. Use it at your own risk. But this is what I'm now using to get the worst of the grime off. Some things like getting into the corners, yeah, still with Q-tips and polishing compound and elbow grease. But if you don't have to spend the elbow grease out here or up here or in the more readily accessible spaces, you can spend a lot more time by hand doing the detail stuff in the corners. Well, there you go. That's what I got for you this week. So remember, checklists, and don't be afraid to use them. They can save you from aggravation, and they can save you from embarrassment. So anyway, that's what I got for you this week. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.